close to my heart, loved and forgiven.
Welcome to this Mass of Requiem, Tēnā koutou katoa, Grace Scott. Please be seated. It is an honour for me to be asked by Anne and the family to lead this Mass of Requiem, a name which just means rest. And that is our prayer today for Josef Jaeger, that he may be at peace, at rest with the God he served so very well. We're conscious that not all the family can be here, so to Diana and Richard in Australia, we send our love and our aroha nui today to you. To the family, we also, on behalf of the parish and your friends here today, offer our prayers and our love and healing for you. To Peter and Lisa, his son Kurt, and we remember, of course, the late George, his grandson, their grandson, who died at aged 14. To Nicola and Peter, to Joseph, Rebecca, and Micah, their great grandson, to Helen and Chris, to David and Catherine, to Carl and Donna, to Louise and her son Leroy, to Crystal and Marcus, their children, Alex, Zoe, and Richard, and the wider family. Our prayers and prayers for healing, prayers for rest are with you today. Let us listen now to the family tributes led for us by Nicola and David and others, and then the photo memories. Thank you.
Please bear with me. I've never spoken before in public, so I'm a little bit nervous. So I'm Nicola, the third of the seven children. And before I start, I'd just like to say that some of what I've got to say here is from Diana in her words. So, because she couldn't be here, she sent some things over and we've incorporated them in this little tribute to Dad. So, on behalf of Mum and my six brothers and sisters, Diana, Peter, Helen and Carl, Louise and Crystal, the grandchildren and great-grandson, thank you for all coming and making Dad's send-off special. He would have so loved having a good old chat with everyone. You know, he couldn't stop talking sometimes. Dad was born in Andelsburg, Austria, a small mountain village, and Dad was the third of six children. Growing up, Dad was a bit of a rascal, pulling harmless pranks, like the time he and a friend were started knocking on the walls of a barn as the farmer's trying to milk his cows, then running and hiding when the farmer comes out. This, of course, wasn't the only time. It had to be repeated several times before they got sick of it. There's one story we all love to hear regarding a chocolate landslide up the mountain. No, and honestly, it was real chocolate. Dad said it was, and that meant it was right, if that's true. And how a little boy, after being told about it by Dad and his friend, went searching for it, and not finding it, came back down in tears, only to be told he hadn't quite gone far enough. So off he went again. And on it goes, you get the gist. The best part was not the actual story, but was seeing the glee in Dad's eyes and the wicked twinkle when he's telling us the story. We loved it. To think that our dad did this, to think that he might have been naughty? No, not our dad, never. Dad's life was uneventful until war broke out when he was 12. In September 1944, Dad was finally conscripted into the army, having failed three previous call-ups because he was underweight. Smoking nail clippings made him sick, and this helped to keep his weight down. After basic training, Dad was sent to the Russian front, where the German army was retreating as the Russians were advancing southwest. Anyway, peace was declared in May 45, and they were told to go home however they could. Dad was captured on the way home by the Czechs, who later turned all the prisoners over to the Russians, who then sent them by cattle train over the Ural Mountains to Siberia to a logging camp just north of Tomsk on the Yaya River. This trip took 2 months. Dad eventually got sick with dropsy and, not expected to survive, was put on the second batch of exchange prisoners out of the camp. Once again, another 2 months on cattle wagons back into Austria, where he was hospitalised for 3 weeks at a Red Cross camp. He arrived back in his home village in January 1946. He was now 19 years old. In April 46, Dad started his engineering apprenticeship and qualified in 1949, and by 1954 he had secured his master's certificate. He then worked for Doppelmayr, erecting ski lifts. He immigrated to New Zealand in 56 and worked and lived in Wellington for the next 4 years. It was on his return trip to Austria in 1960 on the boat that he met Mum, and their love story began. Their lives changed when Dad and Mum locked eyes across the dance floor, and Dad walked over and asked Mum for a dance. From here on, love started to blossom. Dad had never been interested in girls up to this point. He would rather spend time in a workshop than at a dance with silly giggling girls. He was part of a group of guys on the boat who were like-minded. So Mum ended up the only female hanging out with these guys for the next 5 weeks. Now that would have been fun. After arriving in England, Mum headed up to York and Dad over to Austria. Letters and visits exchanged, and on February the 6th, 1961, Mum and Dad married in Dad's village. Mum was 22 and Dad was 33. Dad's workmates got the shock of their lives when, during a lunch break discussion on what they'd got up to over the weekend, Dad casually says, "Oh, I got married yesterday." "Oh yeah, sure," they say, "yeah, right." So Dad explained he got married to a New Zealand girl. Well, of course, they didn't believe him. So Dad, so who goes to work the day after they get married? Our dad. So a few days later, Mum went up the mountain and paid them a visit. Imagine their surprise. Dad was so wicked. We loved a sense of humour. We loved hearing the same stories over the years. We never got sick of them. It was just the way he told them that made them so cool. Mum and Dad returned to New Zealand in 1961, and Dad started building a house in Aorangi Road. Mum by this time had her first baby on the way, and 9 months and 8 days after they were married, Diana was born. then followed the rest of us over 11 years. Dad worked in Paraparam Beach for McGregor Engineering and McGrath Ave for a few years before he started his own business, first working out of the basement of the house and then in a workshop he built in Hinemoa Street. He was able to do this as he was approached by Doppelmayr Austria to be the foreman on building two ski tows in Perisher Valley, Australia. So off he went and was away from home for 5 months, not returning till the job was finished. Dad was foreman on a total of 3 ski lift construction sites in Australasia, Wakapapa and Tekapo ski fields and Perisher Valley. Dad's talent and brains were never ending. If he didn't have a machine for a particular job, he just made one. Mum said all his designing and calculating was done at night, lying in bed. He worked hard, starting at 7 and finishing after dark. I remember that most nights we would be in bed before Dad got home. Dad was also quite artistic. He designed and made wrought iron grills and gates for restaurants and houses, the war memorial gates in Paraparam, and Challenge House Wellington, where he designed and created 2 massive medieval shields. Dad had his hobbies, of course. Very rarely was an hour wasted doing nothing. He restored 2 vintage vehicles, Mum working alongside Dad for hours on end. Dad registered the 1933 Ford truck in Mum's name. This spoke volumes. His love for Mum was obvious. He went on to restore numerous stationary engines, tractors and farm machinery, Mum always helping, always by his side. Dad became a member of the Hutt Valley Vintage Car Club and we went on lots of rallies around New Zealand. We kids got our own set of instructions for the back of the truck and we had fun following these and watching out for clues as Dad drove. By now Mum and Dad were starting to travel again. Dad invented a communion host cutting machine for the local convent back in 79. Cheaper for Dad to make one for the nuns than for them to buy one from Germany. He made 2 more, one now in Dunedin and one for a parish in Colombia where Dad's sister Anna was working. So Mum and Dad went over to Colombia to visit her and check out the machine. This was the first time Dad had seen any of his family in 20 years. On the way to Colombia, Dad got into a bit of strife at a Mexican New Year's party, losing his false teeth down the toilet. Lucky they were able to be retrieved. More travel followed, back to Austria next, but not for a holiday. No, Dad wanted to replace a 300-year-old Alp house that had once been on his land. It took 6 more trips back to Austria to complete the new Alp house. You would have seen this in the slideshow. Dad was a man who believed family was the most important reason we are on this planet. Dad's family is everything. It is the most fundamental reason we are here. Dad did everything for us, worked hard to provide for us and loved us. He loved Mum with all his heart. They worked well together. They just fitted one another. They were one. Dad was kind and compassionate. He believed all humans should be treated as human beings. When in Mexico City in 1980, Dad always went out with coins in his pocket, so every beggar he passed in the street got some money. He couldn't just walk by. They were human beings. They were people. Dad loved to keep up with world events and new technology. He was forward-thinking and loved new ideas. Years ago, there was an electric car show going around the country, and it came to Southwoods. He was there with Mum, chatting to all the guys about these new cars, thought they were great. So years later, for Mum's 80th birthday, he surprised her with a fully electric car. This gave him so much pleasure. Dad always championed the underdog. He believed in fairness. He was a sensible and practical man. And add this to his passionate nature, and boy, he could have some lively discussions, and some of you may know about this. He just totally believed in his convictions. Dad, you were an amazing man, husband and father to us all. Your passing will leave a big hole in all our lives and hearts. We love you and we will miss you terribly. But we will talk about you and to you for the rest of our lives. Love you, Dad.
Hi, I'm David, I'm his grandson, and my speech is not going to be quite to that level. That was something really special, thank you, Nicola. So bear with me, I'm not very good at this either, but I've written a little something because he meant the world to me. Anyway, I don't really know how to start this, but I'll keep it short. There's so much to say, but unfortunately there's not enough time to go through how amazing. Oh God, he was. From a very early age, he's always been one of my biggest inspirations. From bouncing me on his knee and showing me his fake teeth, all the way up to the end where he was still cracking jokes in his 90s. A couple of years ago, I was lucky enough to learn about his time in the war. I learned some things that will be with me forever. From friends to my friends' families, he has been someone who people know and love. I only recently learned that he was a good friend of mine's grandfather's friend. And of course, he built them a staircase, because he built so many things, and that was just one of the many things he's built throughout his life. I also learned that my friend's dad would hide behind his workshop to avoid going to school. His creations and legacy span far and wide, from making all sorts of things in his workshop to making the incredible family I know and love. One of my biggest recent memories that I will hold on to forever is that one time he visited me, Mum, I'm not sure, there might have been a few other family members there, and he was just leaving, and Mum came over and said, "You need to get another walking stick, Dad," and he replies, "I already have two walking sticks." Now that is how I want to be in my later years. We love you, Papa, and you'll be forever in our hearts. Thank you very much.
So I know there's a poem from Rex, is it? It's going to read that from Diana to read just before the photo tributes. Thanks, Rex.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rex. I'm Anne's brother. Always been a brother. This poem is sent to me to read from Diana in Sydney. God looked around his garden and he found an empty place. And then he looked upon the earth and saw your tired face. He put his arms around you and lifted you to rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best. He knew that you were suffering. He knew you were in pain. He knew that you would never get well on earth again. He saw the road was getting rough and hills were hard to climb, so he closed your weary eyelids and he whispered, "Peace be thine." It broke our hearts to lose you, but you didn't go alone, for part of you, part of us went with you the day God called you home. Thank you.
Thank you, Rex and David and Nicola, for those beautiful tributes. We include the tributes by looking at the photo tributes, and that will sort of open our hearts to listening to the Word of God, the beauty and memories of Yosef's life.
to sing. Although the snow covers the whole of spring, somewhere a hill blossoms in green and gold, and there are dreams all that your heart can hold. Thank you.
Kia inoi tato, let us pray. Loving God our Father, it is our certain faith that your Son Jesus, who died upon the cross, is risen from the dead, and is the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep in Christ. Grant through this mystery our brother Joseph, who has gone to his rest believing in Christ, may now share in the joy of his resurrection. And we make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our reading is read for us from Ecclesiastes by Chris Moss. Thank you, Chris.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what has been planted. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to loose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silent and a time to speak. A time for war and a time for peace. God has made everything suitable for its time. This is the word of the Lord. And can we open up our pamphlet? We're going to read together the poem, The Broken Chain. Morning, the God is going to call your name. In life we loved you dearly, in death we do the same. It breaks our hearts to lose you, but you do not go alone. For part of us went with you the day God called you home. You left us peaceful memories, your love is still our guide. And altogether, you are always at our side. Our family chain is broken, and nothing seems the same. But as God calls us one by one, the chain will link again.
Let us stand and welcome the gospel. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. May the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the disciples, I bless you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for hiding these things from the learned and the clever and revealing them to mere children. And then he said, come to me, all you who labor and are overburdened, and I will give you rest. Shoulder my yoke and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. And you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. At the beginning of this very brief reflection on the Word of God, can I say a special thank you to the hospital chaplaincy team who were so very good in ministering to Yosef and to Anne and the family, particularly Father Bill Warwick, the parish priest of Miramar, Holy Trinity Parish, which is now Miramar, Seatoun and Kilburnie, getting up at midnight when he was called to give the last rites to Yosef. And also a sincere thanks to Merle Whiteman, our parish pastoral worker, who has been so helpful with the family in preparing this beautiful liturgy. Nicola, that was an amazing tribute that you and Diane and the family have put together. And also David, I think they're just wonderful memories. And what we do now in our Catholic Requiem Mass is to bring all those memories together. And we think of those readings that the family have chosen, the gift of the seasons. I think growing up in Austria, in Varelsberg, not far from Lake Constance, you see it's such a very, very beautiful country. And so he would have grown up very aware of the changing seasons, the snow. I mean, we can appreciate the snow now because it's on our own hills, light dusting of it, but the radical change of seasons. When we apply that image of the seasons that Chris read for us, we think of all that Yosef lived through. The innocent childhood, the joyful childhood, the photos of him skiing on the snow and that, and then interrupted by the most brutal war and just the horrendous way people were treated. A few years ago I had a wonderful holiday in Villach, in Landskron, so in Carinthia in Austria, up on the border of Italy and Slovenia. And I went to the Kirchtag, which was a wonderful beer festival in the local square. We had a great time and I came home tired but happy. But what really struck me too, without being too heavy about it, when I sat in the town square, was that this square had sort of flowed with the brutality of war and the brutality of blood. And so although it was a peaceful and a beautiful night, you couldn't forget, because the history of the town, and that's about a 5-hour journey from Varelsberg, the history of the town is written into the very ground in Austria and Germany, and that's why I made that pilgrimage from Villach to Auschwitz, just to understand what they had lived through. This is what Tom Brokaw calls the selfless generation. People now in their mid to high 90s who have lived through so much but who have remained people of faith, people of love, people of hope, and people of passion. I'm sure the story's been written, but the number of Austrians who emigrated after the war to New Zealand, I know among other things they built the 500 houses at Titahi Bay. So all those big block of state houses. And then they came up to Kapiti Coast one by one and built their own homes here. And I have been in some of them, and the craftsmanship is just magnificent. So Yosef helped his neighbour, I believe, down in Aorangi Road, build their house first, and then they built the one that Anne and he lived in. Sitting in their home yesterday and talking to Anders and Peter and Lisa very briefly, Anne showed me a 1992 St. Patrick's Parish newsletter. I'm sure not all of you have kept that, but one of the things that was on it was a tribute to the retirement of Joe from all his work at St. Patrick's School. And they honoured him as the engineer, the Mr. Fix-It Man, and said that every piece of sporting equipment, of playground equipment, and all things inside the buildings had been fixed by Yosef. That's just one of the things, one of the ways he made his mark. And probably for me, that was one of the most memorable conversations I had with Yosef and Anne, one of the fieriest conversations, can I say. And it came about because we were about to close St. Patrick's Church, Paraparamu, and the school, and move from there. And I knew Joe was very angry, and I promised to go and meet with him, which we did. And in that balcony where we sat, Anne and I, last night and talked, I was reminded of that sort of deep, heartfelt conversation where he just told it like it was. And you can work with somebody who tells it like it is, because they're honest and it's an unguarded and a vulnerable truth. And I think that's how God works with us, when we're unguarded, when we're vulnerable, when we let our grief show, then God can reach out and so mercifully. And so what I learned is, one parishioner said to me, who was also annoyed and said so, she said this: as a parish and as a people, we need time to grieve, we need time to be angry, and then we need time to be open. When I left that conversation, I said to Joe and Anne, well, we will agree to disagree, but I hope that we can still worship together. And that's precisely what they did. You did. And you came to Waikanae, sat in the back row, in the foyer, but you were there. Always one of the last to come up for communion, but you were there. And then when we had to do the same again to Our Lady of Fatima and come to St. Patrick's as a temporary church, you were there. In the back row, but you were there. And then when the new church was opened, there you were. Down the back, but you were there. That's gutsy faith, because it's agreeing to disagree, it's acknowledging deep pain, it's letting go of something that you had to build, that you put your life and love into, as people did in all those churches, Our Lady of Lourdes and Paikakariki, Our Lady Fatima in Waikanae, and St. Patrick's in Paraparamu, the convent, the school, the other convent in Amohia Street, a couple of presbyteries, letting all that go and embracing a new future. And Joe, was right at the heart and centre, he and Anne, of that faith journey. That's what gutsy faith looks like. That's what the selfless generation looks like. Yes, they can criticise, but they're in their boots and all. At the beginning of Mass, I used the phrase Grescott, and that's a phrase I learnt in the cemetery at Villach in Landskron. And I asked, why do people keep saying to me, to John and Elizabeth that I was with, why when they see me do they say Grescott? And she said, literally it means, Elizabeth, who's Austrian, said, it translates as God greets. And it means this: the God in me greets the God in you. It's a recognition of dignity. It's a recognition of faith. It's a recognition of love. And I think for Yosef, it's a recognition of what he believed in and Anne believed in. This is not all there is. The seasons are not all there are. They're merely the prelude to eternal life with God. And I think that's the gift of faith and love and compassion that I have seen in you, the family, and Anne, as you have cared for Yosef, embracing respite care, being an advocate, watching him fail, his health fail in the last year especially, but the last couple of years, but being there as a family and making a very difficult journey of letting him go back to God. When we say goodbye, we say, God be with you. That's what it means, Grescott. So the God in Yosef, greets us, the God in us. Let's go from here and think about that. How might we honour the God within us? Take time for grieving, take time for family that Nicola said so very well, take time for pride in each other, and take time for ourselves. May he rest in peace. Our Mass continues with the bread and wine, the symbols of Yosef, the gifts that we give back to God that are now brought up by the family. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. It is through your goodness that we have this bread and this wine to offer, which earth has given, which is the fruit of the vine, which is the work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life and our spiritual drink. And so we pray that our bread, our wine, our hearts and our prayers for Yosef may be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Amen. Loving God, in whom sinners find mercy and the saints find joy, we pray to you today for our brother Yosef, whose body we honour with Christian burial, that he may be delivered from the bonds of death and admitted to the joyful company of your saints and all those who have gone before us in this parish and in our families in faith and love. And we make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Jesus. He is the salvation of the world, the life of the human race, the resurrection of the dead. With the saints and angels, we join in their unending hymn of praise.
Holy.
You are holy indeed, Lord, the fountain of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once again he gave thanks. He gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. eat this bread and drink this cup. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, John and Paul, our bishops, and all the ministers of your gospel. Remember Josef Jäger, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may be one with him in his resurrection. Welcome Josef and all our deceased parishioners and loved ones and presentation sisters into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, forever and ever. Amen. So we stand and we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We share a gift of peace with one another. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Please be seated. Ko te tinana o he hukaraiti. This is Jesus, the Lamb of God. We are blessed to be called to the supper of the Lamb. You're very welcome to come and receive Holy Communion. All of you, you're very welcome also to come and ask for a blessing.
Thank you.
Just before the final commendation and farewell prayers, may I thank you on behalf of Anne and the family for your love and your presence and your prayers here today. The burial is private for the family, but you're welcome to join the family now for light refreshments in the Our Lady of Lourdes lounge. Please stand. Before we go our separate ways, we take leave of our brother Joseph. May our farewell continue to express our love for him and ease our sadness and also strengthen our hope. One day, as the poems have said, we shall joyfully greet him and also his beloved George again when the love of Jesus, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. One of the ways we honour the Wairua Tapu, the Holy Spirit, within each one of us here today is to sprinkle holy water on the casket and to incense the casket. So it is our way and sacred ritual of saying Grace Scott. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to his aid, hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you home, Joseph, take you to himself. May the angels lead you to the side of Sarah and Abraham. Eternal rest give to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Into your hands, God of mercies, we commend Joseph in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will live with him forever. We give you thanks for the blessings you gave him in this life and the blessings you gave his family and our faith community through his life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our friendship with the saints in Christ. Joseph, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you home, and where Lazarus is poor no longer at the city gates, may you truly find eternal rest. Amen.
Ci sei tu con me, Hi, Dad. Love you. Dad. Bye. See you up there. Bye.